Thank you. morning, everyone. You can see on the boards the readings for today's Mass are special because today is the Solemnity of the Assumption of the Blessed Virgin Mary. The readings are on page 1275, if you'd like to put a ribbon there. Here with us on earth, celebrating her entire life as victory of her Son and our Savior. The times we ourselves have shrinked away from our mission, from our path of bringing Jesus into the world, we now ask Him for His mercy. On us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting. Majesty, ever-living God, who assumed the Immaculate Virgin Mary, the mother of your Son, body and soul, into heavenly glory, grant, we pray, that always attentive to the things that are above, we may merit to be sharers of her glory. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
God's temple in heaven was opened, and the Ark of His covenant could be seen in the temple. A great sign appeared in the sky, a woman clothed with the sun, with the moon beneath her feet, and on her head a crown of 12 stars. She was with child and wailed aloud in pain as she labored to give birth. Then another sign appeared in the sky. It was a huge red dragon with 7 heads and 10 horns, and on its heads were 7 diadems. Its tail swept away a third of the stars in the sky and hurled them down to the earth. Then the dragon stood before the woman about to give birth, to devour her child when she gave birth. She gave birth to a son, a male child, destined to rule all the nations with an iron rod. Her child was caught up to God and His throne. The woman herself fled into the desert, where she had a place prepared by God. Then I heard a loud voice in heaven say, "Now has salvation and power come, and the kingdom of our God, and the authority of His anointed one." The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since death came through man, the resurrection of the dead came also through man. For just as in Adam all die, so too in Christ shall all be brought to life, but each one in proper order. Christ, the first fruits. Then, at his coming, those who belong to Christ. Then comes the end, when he hands over the kingdom to his God and Father, when he has destroyed every sovereignty and every authority and power. For he must reign until he has put all his enemies under his feet. The last enemy to be destroyed is death. For he subjected everything under his feet. The word of the Lord.
She entered the house of Zechariah and greeted Elizabeth. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the infant leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth, filled with the Holy Spirit, cried out in a loud voice and said, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. And how does this happen to me, that the mother of my Lord should come to me? For at the moment the sound of your greeting reached my ears, the infant in my womb leaped for joy. Blessed are you who believe that what was spoken to you by the Lord would be fulfilled." And Mary said, "My soul proclaims the greatness of the Lord. My spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has looked upon his lowly servant. From this day all generations will call me blessed. The Almighty has done great things for me, and holy is his name. He has mercy on those who fear him in every generation. He has shown the strength of his arm and has scattered the proud in their conceit. He has cast down the mighty from their thrones and has lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he has sent away empty. He has come to the help of his servant Israel. He has remembered his promise of mercy, the promise he made to our fathers, to Abraham and his children forever." Mary remained with her about 3 months and then returned to her home. The Gospel of the Lord. Thank you. like I was saying in the beginning of the Mass, today really is a day of victory. If we consider what true victory is, if we look at the ultimate battle in life is not between flesh, it's not flesh and blood, but it is spiritual warfare. It's the battle between good and evil and the creator of all good and the one who desires to bring evil. Now, the reality is we know the victory, but God lets it unwind. He lets it play out. He seeks and desires that every single one of us fulfills our part in this battle and chooses the right choice. This battle didn't start necessarily at the moment that Jesus came here on earth, but it definitely changed. Even after the time of Jesus, there are people who routinely will try to twist and turn things, and they don't realize it, but in doing so, they're actually leading people astray. One of the most pernicious of all of these heresies is this heresy that Jesus is not God. It is the subtle propaganda, if you will, of Satan to convince us that we cannot put our faith in him because he's not God. This is borne out in many different ages. In fact, in the very early days of the church, we came up with a term in order to protect this truth that Jesus truly is God. But we did it in such a way as to make sure we would never forget the context. And the term is simply one word, Theotokos. And that's Greek for the God-bearer. It's in reference to Mary. Mary is a God-bearer. It should sound incredible. It should sound shocking, because it is. Mary bore God. For many ages, we've had to remind ourselves of this. We often don't think of it this way, but Islam is actually the fruit of a heresy of our Catholic faith. It was born out of a culture and a community that was actually Catholic. But one of the leaders in that community was telling everybody that Jesus is not God. And that heresy found its way as part of Islam. But victory is always one generation away. If you've ever looked at the Quran, Mary is actually referred to over 30 times. Our Mary in the Quran is referred to over 30 times. But it's interesting the way she's referred to, because Muhammad was actually wanting to refer to Jesus, but he was afraid of Jesus. And so he would never call him by name, perhaps worried that his followers would pick up and start asking questions. And so instead, he referred to him through his mother. And in the Quran, it always refers to him as the son of Mary. Now, when we start talking about Mary and spiritual warfare, we also have to talk about tactics. Because God has tactics, and so does Satan. And if one is afraid to say the name of Jesus, perhaps Jesus will take that as an invitation and as a future path of reconciliation and drawing his people back home to truth. She is the God-bearer. She sets an example for us in this spiritual battle. I'm going to be honest with you. None of us is perfect in this spiritual battle. I routinely make mistakes as a pastor. And sometimes I see how that actually harms people's faith. But as parents, you all know the responsibilities that you have. You know the power of your words and the power of your thoughts and your choices. And they impact your children for good or for worse. Mary is an example for all parents. I suppose you could say in a very special way for all moms. example of one of the ways that I made a tactical error the other day. So when we were planning our big feast day for this celebration, which we had last night, with a big party and everything, I came up with the idea that the youth could have a water balloon toss competition. And I'd be very innocent, they would love it because it's going to be hot. That was a tactical error. I did not perceive that in our beloved youth of this community, that they would see it as an opportunity to create a water balloon war. And not only that, but that they would be even smart enough or cunning enough to decide to ambush a particular person at the party. And I was way too naive to think that as I was enjoying a conversation with some of our prisoners at the table, they would sneakily gather around and ambush their pastor. I've never been that wet in many years. I will delight in their confessions later, though. All right. How do we sometimes make errors in our judgment here in the spiritual warfare? We're all guilty of this on some level. What was the first priority in raising children for your family or when you were a child? Was it academics? Academics is good, but it has become an idol. We put it first. We spend energy, time, money, everything on academics. We strive and strive and strive to get our kids so that they can be the best educated person they can possibly be. And all the while, that menacing dragon in the story that we have today in Revelations delights because of our blind spot. For some families, it's academics, but kind of slowly, especially if their children demonstrate a certain talent, sports become the idol. And so every weekend, or even more than every weekend, every evening, families find themselves bringing kids back and forth, back and forth, back and forth, and they train and practice and become better at their particular sports, and there's nothing wrong with sports. But in the midst of the celestial battle, in the midst of this heavenly battle, Our Lady weeps. For these children are often deprived of any preparation or any protection from the evil one. And so as our children become highly intelligent, highly educated, very athletic, they abandon God. And this is the true pandemic. It is leading to death. I don't mean physical death. Physical death will come for us all. When parents, or in my case, pastors, lose their way and use tactical errors, people go to hell. And I'm not saying that in any way to instill fear. It is simply a reality of not preparing our children or protecting them when we need to. And so we go into the book of Revelations today, and you have this cosmic battle. I've talked about it before. And at the front of it, at the center of it, is not some muscular soldier with all kinds of guns and arms, right? Here on earth, we fight our battles that way, but this heavenly battle, those are useless. It is Our Lady. She is the center of it. What is she doing in the midst of this battle with this giant dragon? She's giving birth. You see, we win this battle through life, through love for life. That's why Jesus, when he would take that baton, eventually, and he would proclaim the gospel, he would say, love your enemy, overpower them with your love. That's where the true battle lies. But if we go back into this imagery that St. John had in the book of Revelations, Mary's not afraid of Satan. There's going to be a time, though, where she's going to be called upon to protect her son. Yes, even Jesus as God. She's going to protect her son, and she's going to set an example for us. We must protect our children. Now, I know we all think these things, but sometimes things fall through the cracks, right? Our children are exposed to evil every single day. If they have unhindered access to the internet, they can access things that we wouldn't even have imagined 20 years ago, 30 years ago. And they can get it in 10 seconds. And a lot of parents have no clue. Now, we assume our children are always going to make good and upright decisions, but we also forget that there is one who seeks them out and wishes to destroy them. We must protect our children. I don't want you to take this as me trying to get you to believe that, you know, there's evil lurking around every corner. This is not about fear. Satan's the only one who loves fear. That's his tactic. Ours is the opposite. But protection is called for. We must be diligent. But we're not called to just protect. We must prepare our kids. You see, when Mary was in this celestial battle, there's a time, and if you go back and read it, where God the Father takes Jesus, his son, and then Mary goes down to earth. And it says that she flees to the desert. Now, who does Satan turn to in that moment? Does he go after Jesus? He does not. He goes after Mary. You may think in that story that Mary is fleeing. She's afraid of Satan. He's a menacing dragon. That would be a tactical mistake or understanding it wrongly. You see, she's doing what a good mother would do in that moment. She's leading him astray. She's deceiving him because there's a moment where she needed to protect her son. And so a good parent in doing so is willing to take the brunt of the attack, is willing to make great sacrifices for the sake of protecting their children. Now we know this clearly in physical ways, but in spiritual, we have a long ways to go. All of us, including myself. We often forget to protect our children spiritually. Now, when Mary goes, she goes where? Into the desert. Because there's going to come a time, and you have to use your imagination a little bit here, where for 30 years, Mary and Joseph and their family and the community is going to prepare Jesus. Yes, I know, he's God. But he chose to come as one of us. And in that time, it is the obligation of the parents to prepare. Because they are not going to carry that baton permanently. They're going to pass it on. And this is the way Jesus chose to make the church operate. It's going to be dependent on the faith of every single generation. And we have seen entire cities, entire countries that used to be passionately Catholic and Christian, and it doesn't even exist anymore. The faith. That's what happens when the baton gets dropped. And parents stop protecting and stop preparing. Mary, in this role, I suppose you could say, is a martyr. Just like every single mother. Every mother on some level is a martyr. They give their life day in and day out for the sake of their children. I hope we never forget, though, to do that spiritually. Teach our kids spiritually. Prepare them. Because one day you're going to pass that baton, whether they're ready or not. Let's pray that they're ready. And so there's that day in the desert, Mary passes the baton. She deceived Satan, she brought him out into the desert. And 30 years later, where does Jesus begin his ministry? In the desert. And he begins that fight once again with Satan in the desert. Now, he's going to pass that baton on to the 12 and on to the disciples and from generation to generation. And there are people who have failed in 2,000 years, and there are so many people who have succeeded. And look to Mary to be that shield bearer, to be that God bearer. And they passed on the faith to their children. They protected them and prepared them so that they would lead their children in the ways of faith. As I mentioned, in every story, you will see victory in the last breath of a person's life, gathered, surrounding them with their children, but also our Savior. In Matthew chapter 25, the king says to his servant who's been faithful to the end, "Well done, good and faithful servant." My hope for all of us is that in our last days, we too will hear those words from our Savior. My last point, we have restarted our youth group. It is wonderful, except for their treason last night. These kids are great kids. They've been impacted a lot by the world. There's a lot of ways they've been wounded already, just like we have. But every statistics that they do on youth groups has said the same thing. No matter how good of a group you have, the children will leave the faith if it's not backed by the parents. And every time I go to sleep, I remind myself that if we don't have our parents on board, the baton will not get passed. And so Mary, as in the Feast of the Assumption, she hears our Savior say, "Well done." That once again is our prayer for ourselves. Our faith. Body and soul to glory, Mary shines forth as a great sign of our eternal future as a church. We are still pilgrims as we bring our prayers with her to God our Father.
For the church, that we will look forward to the resurrection promised us by Christ. Let us pray to the Lord. For world leaders, that they will always work for peace. Let us pray to the Lord. For devotion to Mary, that Christians may find unity around the lowly handmaid exalted to glory. Let us pray to the Lord. For our families, that the gentle Queen of Peace may reign in every home. Let us pray to the Lord. For the dead, that they will rise with Christ to rejoice forever with Our Lady and the saints. Let us pray to the Lord.
If you saw in the news, we were praying for the people of Haiti. They had a catastrophic earthquake there, and so just praying for everyone who's been impacted by that and for those who will be assisting them. Also pray for the people in Afghanistan, for the good people who desire peace there, and for those who don't, that they can repent. For them we pray to the Lord. Members of the family of one of our prisoners who just passed away, so we're praying for the eternal rest of Winnie Alonso Blake. For this we pray to the Lord. Father of heaven and earth, our prayers come before you with the help of the glorious ever-Virgin Mary, the first believer who called to share in the glory of your triumphant Son, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen.
Our offertory again is in your hymnal 284. Constantly long for you through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks,
Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For today, the Virgin Mother of God was assumed into heaven. The beginning and image of your church is coming to perfection, and a sign of sure hope and comfort to your pilgrim people. Rightly, you would not allow her to see the corruption of the tomb, since from her own body she marvelously brought forth your incarnate Son, the author of all life. And so in company with the choirs of angels we praise you, and with joy we proclaim. That in serving you alone, the Creator, he might have dominion over all creatures. And when through disobedience he had lost your friendship, you did not abandon him to the domain of death, for you came in mercy to the aid of all, so that those who seek might find you. Time and again you offered them covenants, and through the prophets you taught them to look forward to salvation. You so loved the world, Father, most holy, that in the fullness of time you sent your only begotten Son to be our Savior. Made incarnate by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, he shared our human nature in all things but sin. To the poor he proclaimed the good news of salvation, to prisoners freedom, to the sorrowful of heart joy. To accomplish your plan, he gave himself up to death. Rising from the dead, he destroyed death and restored life. And that we might live no longer for ourselves, but for him who died and rose again for us, he sent the Holy Spirit from you, Father, as the first fruits for those who believe. So that bringing to perfection his work in the world, he might sanctify creation to the full. Therefore, O Lord, we pray, may the same Holy Spirit graciously sanctify these offerings, that they may become the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, for the celebration of this great mystery which he himself left us as an eternal covenant. For when the hour had come for him to be glorified by you, Father most holy, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. While they were at supper, he took bread, blessed and broken, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." Similar way, taking the chalice filled with the fruit of the vine, he gave thanks, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. This is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." We proclaim his resurrection and his ascension to your right hand. As we await his coming in glory, we offer you his body and blood, the sacrifice acceptable to you, which brings salvation to the whole world. Look, O Lord, upon the sacrifice which you yourself have provided for your church, and grant in your loving kindness to all who partake of this one bread and one chalice, that gathered together in one body by the Holy Spirit, we may truly become a living sacrifice in Christ to the praise of your glory. Therefore, Lord, remember now all for whom we offer this sacrifice, especially your servant Francis, our Pope, Paul, our Archbishop, the whole order of bishops, all the clergy, those who take part in this offering, those gathered here before you, your entire people, and all who seek you with a sincere heart. Remember also those who have died in the peace of Christ, and all the dead whose faith you alone have known. To all of us, your children, grant, O merciful Father, that we may enter into the heavenly inheritance. With the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with your apostles and saints in your kingdom, there with the whole of creation, freed from the corruption of sin and death, we may glorify you through your Son, our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. We may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
Peace, Lord.
Let's
offer each other a sign of our Lord's peace. Resurrection through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Announcements. We're going to be redoing the roof this week, theoretically. So hopefully that happens. Rain, they're predicting a little bit of rain. But for those who come to daily mass, if you come and there's nobody in the church, it's probably because we decided to go over to the hall. So if the roofing is becoming too disruptive, mass in the hall. That's just during the week, not for Sunday. Our youth group is, their next event is going to be Friday, this coming Friday at 6:30 p.m. We'll be having another movie night for them. Friday's mass will be at 9 a.m. and not at 10:30. The office will be open after mass today if you need to do any business with the office. There are donuts available if you'd like to hang around outside. And thank you for all your donations. And you can make a donation as you exit. And also just thank you everyone who's been helping to make the last night and our celebration really beautiful. So just thank you all for everything that you've done. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you all. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Mass is ended. Let us go in peace.
Amen.